Would you please join me in the call to worship? O magnify the Lord with me.
Let us exalt God's name together.
We will give thanks to you, O Lord, with our whole heart. We will tell of all your wonderful deeds.
We will be glad and exalted in you. We will sing praise to your name, O Most High.
From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. And indeed, as we come together as a college community here for our commencement in our 76th year as an institution, we come together with hearts filled with praise. Praise to the Lord for the thanksgiving we have of seeing his blessing unfold in the history of this institution. To come to today, to see all of you as a new generation of students and young people, as faculty and staff returning to provide leadership and guidance and assistance along our way. So together as a community, let us indeed rejoice and be glad as we celebrate the beginning of our school year together. Would you please join me in prayer? Father in heaven, indeed, our hearts are glad. We're glad to be your daughters and sons, called to serve you and called to live together in a community that is like-minded in holding you very dearly as our Father, in looking for the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and in celebrating the grace of redemption through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for the call you have placed on our lives to be your citizens in your kingdom, but also to be of specific service to brothers and sisters around the world. And so, Father, as we begin this school year, may we do so with a great sense of purpose, with an assurance of our call, and with joy in our hearts that we can be your light to the world. So we commend ourselves to you and this time of commemoration to you. Through Christ Jesus, amen.
You bring light to the dark. all the earth.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
All the earth.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
One more time, all the earth.
Please be seated.
Thank you all. That is one sweet spot of Kuyper College, is the music we sing here together. It's great. Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and welcome again to the opening convocation of academic year 2014-2015. And for many of you, these last 2 weeks almost, week and a half, have been filled with a lot of firsts. First night in the dorms, first new roommate, first meal in the dining hall, for some of us, the first ride on the rapid on Saturday morning, first Kuyper track meet, men's soccer game, first class with our incredibly gifted professors. And later today, the first time you'll be able to dunk our VP for Business and Finance and our president. What could be more for our firsts? But this opening convocation is our official first start to this academic year. And it's good to mark that, even if we've been in class for 3-4 days already. And so I also want to take this time not only to welcome all of you as new students, returning students, whether you're first time or transfers, we just want to welcome you, and we hope that your stay already in this last week has been very good, and Kuyper is that good place to be. We appreciate you being here. But I also want to welcome our new faculty and staff, and some new faculty and staff that really aren't new to us, but are new in some of their positions. So I'm going to read their names, and if you are here present, would you please stand and stay standing, and we'll welcome you all at the end. And if those I read are not here, at least you'll know who they are, and when you see them on campus, you can welcome them as well. So in our academic side, in teaching and administrative faculty, we have two new people with us, and we're very glad for that. We have Professor Mark Andreas with the Business Leadership Program, and we have Mr. Kyle Wiegboldy serving as our new registrar. But we also depend greatly and really appreciate the work of our adjunct instructors, and we have several new adjunct instructors with us. Dr. Emily Brink will be serving in our music and worship internship, and Ms. Dana Ezekian in applied piano. Dana, I saw you here, I think. And Ethan Ezekian in applied guitar. We have Dr. Kara Kitts in our Human Biological Sciences, Mrs. Katharina Matthews in Applied Voice, Mr. Jeff Timmer serving as RD, Career Services, and now our adjunct for Intro to Music, and Ms. Angela Zondervan in our Business Econ program. So can we just welcome all of our faculty and instructors? You may be seated. Thank you. In athletics, we have one of those people that has been and is now in a new position, and he's affectionately known as Rev Ev. We have Reverend Evan Harima serving as our athletic chaplain this year. And two new coaches, Mr. Brandon Klump, one of our alum, is the men's basketball assistant coach, and Mr. Kern Matthews is the men's soccer head coach. So welcome in athletics. In student life, we always provide services for counseling, and this year we have two new counseling interns, Mr. Mitchell Jagger and Ms. Lindsay Stolch, and they will be available through Student Life Office, so we're thankful for them being a part of Kuyper as well this year. And I also want to acknowledge not someone that's new, but someone that has been promoted, and that's always an important thing to do here in an academic setting. And so I want to acknowledge Professor Lisa Hogaboom. And she's not only been promoted as mother to mother-in-law, that's important, but from the assistant professor to associate professor of intercultural and biblical studies. Congratulations, Professor Hogaboom. Okay. Cheering section there, yes. So. And we just wish you God's greatest blessings as you continue your studies and your doctrine, as you teach so many different courses here and are loved by this fan of students. So congratulations. Our mission at Kuyper College is to equip all of you with a biblical reformed worldview so you can serve effectively Christ's church in the world. And maybe you've heard that, and maybe you're wondering, okay, what is that going to mean? Where am I going to serve? How am I going to serve? I'm not even sure what program I'm going to be in yet. But that's what your stay here at Kuyper College is all about. And this mission means that we want to help come alongside and equip you in body, soul, and mind for what God intends to do in and through you here at Kuyper and beyond. And we talk a lot about character virtue, and we talk a lot about spiritual virtues. You all are familiar with Galatians 5, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience. We take those things seriously. But we also want to talk this year about intellectual virtue, that idea of helping us develop thinking behaviors, curiosity, tenacity, open-mindedness, humility, that will not only help us in our studies and other experiences here at Kuyper, but will enable us as we go into the world and into the church to serve Christ and to serve others. And so as a faculty, we've been thinking about that this year. In fact, 2 weeks ago, we had a faculty retreat, and we all committed to reading a book together, and some of you are going to even see this through Dr. Parler's class. We committed to reading this book together to talk about that ourselves. What does it mean for us as faculty to think about this as lifelong learners, developing, fostering in us, and holding each other accountable to develop these intellectual virtues? And then how do we help the community at large at Kuyper College to do the same? So that's what this year is about, and you'll see signs of that in Merge, in some classes, in some classrooms, in some conversations with teachers. And I just want to encourage you to give some thought, pay some attention to that. Maybe it's new ideas you haven't thought of and new ways of thinking you haven't regarded, but it's something we want to be intentional about. So much so that we've kind of fostered this time today in our address to undergird that through what Dr. Cruzzi's going to share in his address, Pursuing Wisdom. So I want to introduce Dr. Cruzzi, and for most of you, he's very familiar. In fact, I guess I would call him an irreplaceable professor of Bible and theology. They all are irreplaceable, but he certainly is. I think Dr. Cruzzi is so irreplaceable because he shows an incredibly deep love and commitment to Christ and to God's Word, and it oozes from him in his teaching, in his conversation, and in his mentoring, and so much so that even his educational path shows that as well. He studied here when Kuyper College was Reformed Bible College. He did studies at Calvin College, undergrad, at Fuller Theological Seminary, and then he pursued his doctoral training at University of Wisconsin. And in all of that, Dr. Kruse was about learning more about God and his word so he in turn could teach and preach that. And that's exactly what he's been doing since 1999 here at Kuyper College. So those of you that are in OT survey, you have had a foretaste of Dr. Kruse. And those of you that are in some electives, you have a continuing taste of what he can bring here. Dr. Kruse also serves as a preaching pastor on Sunday. So what he talks about in the classroom, he preaches about on Sunday. And that's that sense of continuity within his love and his wisdom and his insight into God's word. So this morning, he's going to help us think about what undergirds all that we do when God calls us to renew our minds, to go about being transformed, as Paul said, by the renewing of our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. So I want to welcome Dr. Dan Kruse as our convocation addressee. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Patty. Good morning, everybody. First of all, I think probably everybody is replaceable. So I'm not that overconfident that I can't be replaced. You know, one of the problems about hanging around really smart people is that they often work really hard to let you know how smart they are. The old story, I don't know if it's true or not, but old story about Albert Einstein and his chauffeur. How in the early days, Einstein would go around giving this lecture from town to town and place to place. And the chauffeur, of course, drove him around and was with him every night and heard that same lecture every night. Like 100 times he heard that thing. And he just kind of got sick of it. And so he finally said to Einstein, "You know, Einstein, I've heard that lecture so often, I think I could give it." And Einstein said, "Well, then why don't you?" And so they agreed to switch places the next night. And the next night, the chauffeur pretended to be Einstein, and Einstein dressed up like the chauffeur, and the chauffeur went all the way through this lecture, and it all went fairly well until the very end, when there was always this Q&A time. And somebody from the audience raised their hand and asked a very, very complex question about quantum physics or something like that, and the chauffeur stood there for a moment and thought, and then he finally said, "That question's so easy, I'm going to let my chauffeur handle that one." See, that's the problem with hanging around smart people. They'll let you know how smart they are. Well, see, the thing here is, we don't want to just tell people how smart we are. We want to actually be smart. You know, in a world where perception and image is everything, you know, we don't want to just give the impression of being intelligent. We want to actually have intelligence. In a world that is enamored with virtual reality and imitation, we don't want to just have virtual intelligence. We want to genuinely and authentically be wise people, loving God with all of our minds, thinking well, gaining knowledge about Him and His world. But I got to tell you, at Kuyper College, we're doing something even more than that. We're aiming even higher than that. Because we don't want to just produce brainy, smart people. No, we've set the goal a bit higher. No, I guess God has given us a higher purpose. And that higher purpose, as we have already referred to and will be referred to throughout the year, that higher purpose is to cultivate and develop something called intellectual character so that we can become people of virtuous minds, so that we can reflect scholarly, ethical qualities like intellectual courage, intellectual tenacity, curiosity, fair-mindedness, and honesty. That's what we want to do. Now there's a, a single book in the Bible that actually lays out the foundation of this whole educational process and the goal of intellectual character, and it is the Old Testament book of Proverbs. It has a very similar purpose and goal to what we're doing here in education. And we're introduced to that in the very first verses of this Old Testament book. I'm going to read these verses in just a moment, and I want you to pay attention to the fact that what we'll hear here in these verses is that the author is giving us a mental purpose and also a moral purpose. And when you put those together, what you get is intellectual character. Listen to the Word of God. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. For gaining wisdom and instruction, for understanding words of insight, for receiving instruction in prudent behavior, doing what is right and just and fair, for giving prudence to those who are simple, knowledge and discretion to the young. Let the wise listen and add to their learning, and let the discerning get guidance. For understanding proverbs and parables, the sayings and riddles of the wise. And then the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. Did you hear it? There's a mental task that is before us. We are going to have to understand words of insight, and we are going to have to do some asking of questions, listening to others, engaging in a scholarly academic conversation around issues, making comparisons, weighing different arguments, figuring out what proverbs and riddles mean. You're going to have to use your head. And then, of course, all of this, of course, there's a moral purpose. Because we want to do this not just to be smart, but we ultimately want to be able to do what is right and just and fair and bring value to other people's lives. We want intellectual character. But right there in those verses, did you hear it? The book of Proverbs adds a very unique pedagogical structure to this whole educational process. And it is encapsulated at the very beginning of the process by this concept, the fear of the Lord. Did you hear that? The fear of the Lord, everybody, is the beginning of wisdom. It's the beginning. It's the starting point. You can't do anything successfully to the highest degree without this beginning. And now I think what this means at the initial stage is that it requires that initially, as young students, we need to acknowledge God. It's as simple as that. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Acknowledge God, that this is His world, that He is sovereign, that Scripture is true and authoritative, that God has a purpose for us and this world. Ibn Ezra, the Jewish medieval commentator, said, "The fear of the Lord is the first thing to know, and afterwards one may learn and know everything else." That's good. Of course, sort of makes it an epistemological statement, doesn't it? About how we know things, about how we know what we know. You need to start with the fear of the Lord. The starting point of the educational process and the acquisition of knowledge begins with a sense of God, which also reflects certain beliefs about God and humanity and the relationship between them. The fear of the Lord is the sphere within which wisdom and intellectual character is cultivated. It is the precondition for wisdom and ethical behavior. So let me ask you, at the initial stage of the year and of your education, do you fear God? Have you acknowledged Him? have you knelt before him first? Then you may know everything else. There's another little passage in Proverbs that devotes special attention to the education education as a topic in itself, and that's Proverbs 2. I'm going to read just a few verses here too. We saw the role of the fear of the Lord at the beginning of the process, and now in this chapter, amazingly, we see the same concept, the fear of the Lord, standing at the end of the process. This is Proverbs 2. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, indeed, if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Did you hear that? There are some conditional statements there, right? If. And this is your task as a student. Those conditional statements sort of mark off the phases of the learner's task. If you passively absorb the professor's or teacher's or your father's words, if you actively call out to wisdom, if you take the initiative to seek it, then the apodosis is, then you will understand the fear of the Lord. Now that is a surprising pedagogical twist. Did you hear it? Because you would expect in chapter 2 that a student or someone who goes on a quest for wisdom would culminate in finding, well, wisdom. But here, this verse makes an even greater claim. What you find at the end is an understanding of the fear of the Lord. What we get is something even better as we give ourselves to the educational process. Its promise is no less than religious enlightenment, the understanding of the fear of the Lord and the knowledge of God. And this understanding consists in a mature insight into what it means to fear God. I've argued elsewhere in other writing, I won't do that here, but that this fear of the Lord at the end of the process, at its mature stage, really represents moral conscience. At the initial stage, it's a simple acknowledgement of God. Begin the process. At the end, what is cultivated in us along the way is this deep moral conscience, an inner sense of right and wrong, and more importantly, a desire to do what is right. Great claims are being made here for wisdom, saying that the intellectual powers that bring success in everyday life belong to the wisdom that comes from God and culminates in religious consciousness and moral conscience. See, what you get at the end is not just knowing what the right thing to do is and then even doing the right thing, but what you get is a knowledge of why you're doing it and, most importantly, wanting to do it. See, the fear of the Lord supplies the reason and prompts the desire. Moral character, intellectual character, is the greatest goal of education. But it's also the greatest challenge. Because moral character comes down to desiring. And how can we teach desire? Well, that's the fear of the Lord. As we give ourselves to the educational process, to the pursuit of intellectual character, God will work in His mysterious way by His Holy Spirit and through the Word and through the lessons, and He will shape us into intellectually moral people who want to be like Him and reflect His wonderful character. But I got to tell you, there's even more at stake here. You thought the stakes were high now. There are more at stake for those of us at Kuyper College who are ministry focused, because intellectual character is very wonderful. More knowledge is better. You become a better thinker. You become someone who can appreciate the wonders of the world around us. There are so many other benefits. But what you really get, according to Proverbs and God, what you really get in this process is life with God. And what you really get is a relationship with Him. And what you really become is someone who can change the lives and eternities of the people that you minister to. When I was in grade school, you know, we used to have this little thing that we did, a little phrase that we used. You know, somebody on the playground would say something like, "Yeah, I really love that hot dog." You know, and it was considered funny in those days. You know, the response would be, "Well, if you love it so much, why don't you marry it?" Oh, good, you went to the same school I did. The bar wasn't very high for funny there, but we thought that was funny. You know, if you love it so much, why don't you marry it? Well, here's the thing. Israel loved wisdom so much that they wanted to marry it. And so they personified it. And they talked about it as if it was a person, as if it was the most wonderful person in the world. They talked about wisdom as if she were the most beautiful woman ever. Pictured wisdom as a woman. I think the reason the Bible pictures wisdom as a woman is because women are, well, wise, everybody. Wise. Wisdom is wonderful. Israel loved it. And I'll tell you, wisdom makes for better character. It makes for better friends. It makes for better workers. It makes for better students and better colleges and better communities. But here's the thing. Wise people still get cancer. And wise people still get betrayed. And wise people still die. And we have an even greater need than even for intellectual character, as wonderful as that is. Even the Bible recognizes the limits of human wisdom. See, our greatest need is that we're dying. Isaiah said, "All the people are grass. You are grass. The grass withers, the flowers fall." What we need, everybody, is life from God. And in Proverbs and in Scripture, this is what God offers in this process. In Proverbs, personified wisdom cries out from the highest point in the city and then comes to the lowest place on earth. And we remember a little baby was born, and as that little baby grew and developed, Luke says he grew in wisdom beyond his years. And there is a real interesting wisdom theme around Jesus. He said things so unusual that Mark says people asked, "Where did he get all of his wisdom and authority?" And then gradually over time, the New Testament writers who were raised to love wisdom and cherish it and revere it realized that in Jesus something had happened. Paul says that God made Christ to be wisdom itself. And then Paul writes this fabulous passage in Colossians 1 that uses images that described wisdom back in the Old Testament, but he's applying them all now to Jesus. And he says, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation." See, that was wisdom. "For by him all things were created, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things." And anybody reading that would recognize that those statements are statements that God made about God's wisdom. And then Paul says, "In him, in Jesus Christ, all things hold together." Well, of course they do, because he owns it all and made it all and has given us the task to look at it and probe it and lift it up and think about it and consider it and listen to it. That's what we're doing. in Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And then one day the wisdom and logos and mind and intelligence of God became flesh. And wisdom said strange things that nobody ever said before, like take up your cross and die to yourself. And then if you die, you'll live. And wisdom loved and wisdom suffered on a cross. And wisdom died and wisdom was raised again. And wisdom, thank God, is far more than common sense and living well and intellectual character even. Wisdom bets it all on God, and dies on a cross and gets resurrected on the third day. And the writers of the New Testament realized that all that they loved and prized about wisdom, they found in Jesus Christ. And Jesus has a bride. And that bride is called the church. It's us. And so let me tell you, if you love him so much, this Lord of all, this wisdom of God, this Savior of all people, if you love him so much, then why don't you marry him? And one day we will.
Will all the students please rise and pray the prayer of dedication with me? God of love, as in Jesus Christ you took on our flesh, so may we clothe ourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. Continue to wake us to the wonder of our salvation. Guide us by the renewing of our minds, so that we may know your good, pleasing, and perfect will. Assist us, Holy Spirit, as we put aside deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Keep our feet firmly in the way where Christ leads us. Help our lips to speak the truth that Christ teaches us. Fill our bodies with the life that is Christ within us, evidenced by our purpose, our unity, our purity, and our passion for justice. We pray this in order that your name may be magnified and your church would be strengthened. In Jesus' name and by the power of the Spirit, amen.
Faculty and staff, as you are able, please stand and join me in this prayer. God of love, as in Jesus Christ you took on our flesh, so may we clothe ourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. Grant that we would be faithful stewards of time, regular in prayer, meditation, and your word. Assist us, Holy Spirit, as we put aside deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. May we be good stewards of the gifts you have given us. Open our eyes and hearts that we would serve others generously and work for justice in human relationships as well as in social and educational structures. May your word so saturate our lives that it flows from our lips naturally. As we put on Christ, we pray that our lives would evidence your presence in all that we say, all that we do, and all that we are. We ask this in order that your name would be magnified and your church would be strengthened. In Jesus' name and by the power of the Spirit, amen.
And would you all please at this time rise for the biblical charge. Kuyper community, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and then put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand so that it gives light to all who are in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and may glorify your Father who is in heaven. Let us then go and let our light shine.